day a different coast. I'm doing shit the way I'm supposed to. Flying private way from coach. Was a player now.
Hey man, what's going on, family? Welcome to the Halftime Company Radio Show, man. Y'all know who it is. It's your boy Uncle JB with my man Biscuit Head Nick.
What it is.
And today, man, we got a special one for you, man. We got a amazing crew coming out of Florida. I cannot wait to introduce these brothers. They doing their own thing, moving in their own lane. And I'm telling you, you're going to love these brothers. I want to welcome to the stage the LoUd Life crew. What's going on, fellas?
Hey, gang shit, Big L. Hey, what's happening? What's
Thank y'all good? For having us. We appreciate
sir,
it.
Sir, real yes, quick, sir. Just for the family, man, if y'all want to just go through, just introduce yourselves real fast.
Well, shit, I'll go first. You already know my name, Marvelous, Marvelous on all platforms. Google me. And, yeah, I'm from Colorado. I appreciate, you know, feel me, Halftime Company hosting this and shit. I appreciate Austin for showing mad love. We came all the way out here for South by Southwest and shit. But, yeah, I go by Marvelous.
I go by Swizzy.
No, I go by Noopy Neymon. Big L's. Hyped to be in Austin. And thank you for having me, too, man. You know what I'm saying? It's been life-changing, really stepping into Austin. You know, South by Southwest is crazy already, and we just getting into it.
Marvin said, you know, earlier, like, you said it was spiritual in a way, right?
Oh, yeah, it's a spiritual experience out here, absolutely. Yeah, if you're an artist on your path, coming out to Austin, Texas during this specific time frame, it's a spiritual experience. It's there's just so many different ways, absolutely. But I believe the social connection and the growth, the inevitable growth too. I feel like you just come out here, the minimal you're gonna do is go further in your fucking career. You know what I'm saying? That's just the bare minimum and shit. You feel me?
I feel that. You feel me? And like, so how has it been so far in Austin for y'all as a group? Like,
it's been lit. Everybody that we came across loves us, that we performed. We performed at Floating World last night, Sigil Night with Kill Cody on Tuesday. And every time we performed, like, it was just, the energy was just crazy. Yeah. So we really can't wait to start tapping into, like, the 6th Street shows and stuff. That was over in Round Rock, but tonight and the rest of the week, we on 6th Street downtown. So we about to go crazy.
Crazy. Y'all be wilding out here. Y'all be going crazy over here.
Austin go crazy.
Y'all got mental issues.
It's right up our alley, too.
And actually, speak about that, man. Like you said, right up your alley. Y'all all in a different little lane, right? Like most people will listen to it. Like when I listen to your music, I'm like, okay, this is rap, and I'm listening to y'all rapping, right? But then y'all also have that lane where it is headbanging music, like a punk rock style. Like, how would you explain it to people?
That's exactly what I would explain it as.
Genre bending. I know that's how corny. Nigga, I'd hate to say that, but like,
no, that's what it is, though. Bending, I mean. It has like a lot of inspiration from like rock and like punk rock specifically, and like the you know, auto tuney trap type. So we're like fusing all that together to create like a whole new sound, pretty much.
You're dealing with some primetime 90 baby type facts, so like he was really in the Goldilocks zone of just time, you feel me? He was back when VHSs and tapes was a thing, and cell phones, and so you feel me? It's almost like represents our music too. It's like we got a fusion of just the old, the new, and whatever.
That's one of the biggest things we take pride on too, is our like skill level of lyricism and writing and stuff, being able to arrange certain musics and
not
like
just screaming in a song,
just screaming, or just simply just rapping a bunch, rhyming a bunch of random words, like, you know, we
Cause let's put that on record. Niggas who do that shit are garbage, bro.
I mean, cause we understand, like, you got the work ethic, and then you got the skill and talent. And like, you remove the work ethic, you still have to have the skill and talent. You know, you still got to go to the gym and practice your shit. So like, that's like, that's kind of like where we come from.
So like, in terms of finding that, like, how do you find that on that journey? Let's talk a little bit about, you know, rap. Nobody doing that. Yeah, nobody merging
those
two.
Honestly, it was more of like we've been doing music for about 10 years, me personally. So like, I first started off as like a backpack, you know what I'm saying? Conscious, trying to tell my story and my struggle every single possible chance I could get. And like, I don't know, at the end of the day, it started becoming like not fun to me anymore. Like, not enjoy. I started going to like, you know, like raves and like stuff like that. And like, it was just a different kind of energy and sound that I was hearing, like the EDM drops that were coming in. And I just wanted to start incorporating that into my music. And like, that's when I just started like, all right, let me start going into a whole different lane and experimenting with like the sound just to see what happens. And like, when I started doing it, it was literally the first one. Everybody was like, bro, this don't even sound like you. And I was like, oh, that's exactly what I wanted to hear.
How old was you?
What was that?
How old were you when you...
When I started doing the... Which one? Started making music? I was 16 when I started.
I was saying like when you found that kind of that groove.
About 25?
Okay.
Yeah, bro.
So like you were in it. Like,
yeah, dude, I was going way too hard. Like I was focused on one thing. And like I was trying to... It was more of like this is what's real hip hop. And this is... We have to... If we're not doing it like this, we're doing it wrong. And like that's kind of where my mentality was. And I found out that that's not the right mentality you're supposed to have. You're supposed to truly be yourself. And like really put yourself out there like that. And when I started tapping into that is when it all kind of like came together.
I would say like minds attract each other, so it's like we really all found each other, came together. So he's from Orlando. Really, I gotta tell the story like that. He's from Orlando. You started this shit. Yeah, in 2012, right? You started this shit in 2012. And to not get into what happened between 2012, but long story short, we all linked in Colorado, right? And Colorado is Midwest. And, like, that's, like, a first of all, that's landlocked. So, like, the way Colorado get down, they support independent and they support indie and alternative on top of supporting them, whatever the mainstream can feed them. But I say that to say, like, just me naturally, you know what I'm saying? My sister put me on, like, Slipknot, Tech N9ne, and, like, just some awkward, like, not everybody can get into this type music, you know what I'm saying? So
that's a good point too. That I think that's why, like, as far as Loud Life Crew, the group, why it's very diverse and versatile in like the genres we do, because he's from Colorado, has like, exactly what he came up off of. He came up off of Michigan.
I'm from Michigan, and like, so like being from Michigan, you know, it's like all Motown out there, you know what I'm saying? I'm from that, like I got that on lock. But like, my brother put me on rock music at a young age. And like, we're a music family from where I'm from. So like, my dad, man, shout out to my pops, you know, I gotta do it. Yeah, but now my dad went on tour with the Temptations and growing up hearing this and knowing this, like, I'm with my pops, he got a Bill Music Star in Memphis. Mm-hmm. Like that should, or a like music the note. It's like the Hollywood Walk of Fame, but it's in Memphis. Yeah, my daddy got one of them, you know what I'm saying? That shit blew my mind. I was like, oh, okay, pops. And I already knew, you know, we got it like that. But I think when I met these dudes, bro, you know, like you said, we're not going to talk about, like, the point. But, like, nigga, that point made me want to link up. As soon as I met Swizzy, I was like, yeah, bro, I've been trying to find you, nigga. You know what I'm saying? And then through Swizzy, me and Marv got down. I met Marv one time prior to that, and it was just, like, rivals.
And it's crazy because we from all different locations. He's from Colorado. He's from Michigan. We from Florida. And we all met in Colorado. And it was just a weird universal thing.
And truth be told, I didn't even really fuck with this nigga.
Nah, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
It's like we're supposed to be on the same team and shit.
It's supposed to be my like team member. I'm like not fucking with this nigga. You feel me? And then at the beginning, the way it was structured, there was so many motherfuckers on the crew.
Yeah, we were about 10 deep at one point. Yeah.
Long story short,
we're like Wu-Tang on for real, like 10 deep.
But long story short, it took a minute to get that organic. I remember me and him weren't too connected till I moved closer to where he was staying, right in my hood and shit. Boom, boom. He was right there up the street. That's when it was me and him were able to like lock in. I was able to spend every day with this nigga plotting and planning, meticulously tweaking the motherfucking master plan. You know what I'm saying? Spending them, putting them hours in and
where
shit.
Where in Colorado where you live at?
Shit, I'm from Springs, nigga.
Okay.
You feel me? Southside, for real, for real. But
that's what's up.
Yeah, I'm from Colorado Springs, but
I lived out in Colorado for about 6 years.
What part you went to?
I was actually in Gunnison.
Gunnison?
Gunnison, Colorado.
Yeah, I've never been there.
I was there in the mountains. And then I moved to Denver for 2 years, but I ran track, played football at Western.
Okay. Well, then,
I was an athlete. That's the reason why
I was
there.
I was saying Colorado, that's an Olympic city, you feel me?
Yeah. I mean, 7,700 feet in the air. You know what I mean? It's the highest collegiate track in the world.
You know
so.
And I feel like we have that advantage as far as, like, so we were able to develop a lot of our, like, show presence and, like, the shit that we got going on. Nigga, we're a mile-high city jumping around. So we come down to the sea level. It's like we're about to eat that shit up.
We're, like, running back and forth on stage like a track meet.
And I love what y'all was talking about with your group. and the story of coming together, because I feel like what is cool about y'all is I'm sure that y'all have seen it, but y'all's music and what y'all putting out is different because of y'all being in the group. Like, what y'all be putting out individually would be completely different if y'all had never gotten in this group. And so y'all affecting each other and pushing each other, and that's something
like
I also
you said, kind of like, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like Goku.
That's what it is. It's all about just inspiring right, each other.
Yeah. Like, oh, Dragon Ball. You feel me? Vegeta got to get stronger because Goku's turning up.
Yeah.
Vegeta hit a peak. Goku's
finna Goku see him one up. Man,
but it's friendly competition. And that's the beautiful part. It's like seasons. Nigga, it'll be Noopy season, you feel me? And all his shit's hitting. It'll be Swizzy shit season, all his shit's hitting. But then it's like, it's also like, how do I explain it, nigga? It's like Voltron, nigga. Or Power Rangers.
Yeah.
When we come together to create the big Megatron, you know what I'm saying? But we're standalone. We can stand on business standalone. You
yeah,
know
exactly.
What I'm saying?
Like, and that's why I wanted to bring up, like, we're kind of like Wu-Tang because we are our own individual artists. Like, you could catch a Noopy Namon headlining tour, a Marvelous headlining tour, a Swizzy headlining tour, but then the LoUd Life crew headlining tour is a whole nother level of thing. Yeah. It's kind of like, oh, you can catch Raekwon on tour and RZA on tour, but when Wu-Tang comes together, it's a whole nother, and that's kind of the what we're trying to put together and what's actually been working too. Like, yeah. It's been crazy.
So it seems like, man.
Yeah.
And how is Florida? Like, y'all,
Florida's our hub. Yeah, Florida's our hub.
That, I mean, he from there, so he was already plugging, and beautifully he left. You know how they say crab barrel or whatever? He left his little crab barrel, came to Colorado, ran it up in there. That's my crab barrel. Mm-hmm. I left my crab
barrel. Yeah, brought him back into mine.
You know what I'm saying? And then the left finessing the left hand, because the left hand doesn't know what the right hand does, and just spinning and marketing and doing it like that. You feel me? And then branching out, because it's not even outside of Colorado and Florida, nigga. We was doing, I think, my first out-of-state show when he had put me on, it was like 2017. Yeah, he took me to go open up for B.O.B. at this festival and shit. You know what I'm saying? In Montana and shit. That was like my first, like, oh, wow, I'm so glad I met this nigga. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Straight up, bro.
Straight up. But yeah,
shit,
no.
Shit,
that's comedy.
Speaking of opening, who's like, who have y'all opened for?
Way
who?
Too a laundry list.
Sheesh. Yeah, like, we can name what, like the
tell
our favorites.
Yeah,
for sure.
Tell your favorites. Like,
so
y'all
what?
Open
for Raekwon.
Raekwon from Wu-Tang Clan. Young Dolph.
Rest in peace,
Young Dolph.
Yeah, big Dolph shit.
Snow the Product. We've done so many shows and tours with Snow the Product. I don't know if you know who that is.
Soulja
Boy. She's fire. You got to check her out. Soulja Boy.
Oh, Ice Spice Glorilla.
Ice Spice Glorilla. Yeah.
Like, Orlando is hot, so anything that y'all
Nardo
catch,
Wick, yeah, honestly.
Nardo, yeah. The laundry.
I don't remember, bro, so many people that
we got our
open
personal
for.
But
we're
still, we
biggest,
also, right? But see, so they say like, Orlando hot, right? But, like, also, I feel like we got to talk about it. Like, shit, LoUd Life, like, we ran a gauntlet, you feel me? Like, the reason people fuck with us on some real shit, I think, is because, like, we literally pulling up like we pulling up now. Mm-hmm. And then, like, then we just run that shit.
Run it. Till the tires fall off, man.
Some people done told us, like, yeah, I'm not really with the screaming, but, bro, y'all are working. Y'all shows look crazy, bro. Keep going. Don't stop. So it's like, even the people that don't even like the music are supporting us. Like, that's how we know we're on the right path. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, look, I got to give it y'all flowers, man. Like, to be honest, right, like, when I'm introduced to new music, I love music. I love all genres of music. And when I listen to music, I actually listen to it. And when the way y'all put y'all's cadence together, I don't care if there's screaming involved or nothing, the way it flows, the way it balances, doesn't make me move. I mean, if I had that when I was running track or, you know, on the football field, I'd be ready to run through somebody's chest. You know what I'm saying? So
it says somebody's chest, boy.
Like, it's, I gotta give y'all flowers too on the other aspect, the personal aspect. Like, we just met y'all today.
Yeah.
And it feels like we've known y'all for weeks. Oh, you know what I'm saying? Because y'all so cool, down to earth. You're not like, you know what I'm saying, we too good for nobody.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful aspect to have while you're also doing your artistry, you know what I'm saying, and trying to find your own lane.
Shit, truth be told, that's what got us, you know,
through so many doors. Yeah,
yeah,
honestly.
That's what got us here in the first place. You know,
some people would just be like, bro, I fuck with y'all. Y'all want to do this festival?
Yeah, don't really fuck with the music. Don't think we look cool and shit, but just like, oh, that nigga's a cool person or
that part. Yeah, that's really where, like, we got a lot of opportunities is really just being, like you said, like, we don't feel like we're better than nobody. Yeah, we feel talented and skillful, and like, we can out rap artists for sure, but at the end of the day, we're gonna treat everybody like a human being.
People put their nose up for the wrong reasons. Like, it's artists that's like really out here thinking they're better than people. Like, and that's mind-boggling. That, you know what I'm saying? People come up here to y'all and not be fam. Like, y'all cool as hell. Like, y'all really the shit. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, so it's easy. It's easy to be like cool as fuck with y'all. You know what I'm saying?
100%.
And that's also part of, like, the that's how you gain an organic motherfucking fan. Because it's like, if you're looking at somebody online, you're not going to have a personalized experience. Exactly. It's going to be harder to want to support that nigga when he's talking about buy my shirt for $30 or $50 or whoop-de-wop. But, like, even applying it to myself, nigga, some of my favorite celebrities that I ended up meeting is because we ended up meeting, having the experience, and the advice was exchanged, the interaction, you feel me? So it's like, that's... part of the matic, it's a numbers game. So it's like, you got to shake a million hands, make a million fans.
And we know that. We've known that for years since we came together.
You can't fake the funk on that.
And that, and you can't. And that's what a lot of people try to do. And like, you can fake a following, you can't fake a fan base.
Yeah, that part. Or an organic, loyal, quality. We would rather quality. We'd rather 100 lions than 1,000 sheep, you heard?
Exactly. Yeah, and that's really why we're so adamant on, like, let's pull up. It don't even matter how far, let's book our flights, our hotels, the opportunities, the value here. It doesn't matter about anything else. And like, that's what got us, like,
because you really touch that one person's gonna tell somebody about you.
Exactly. And it happens every time, you know. And then it's just a matter of time of just consistently being like that, and then it all comes together
like a little,
it's inevitable.
A little pebble still gonna create a ripple in the lake, right?
Exactly. The smallest one will still create a ripple.
You ain't gotta worry about always finding the biggest rock.
Another thing too, man, like, we done did some shows where there's like just the bartenders, and we'll put on a show, we'll still rock, headbanging, moshing with the two people in the crowd. So I think that's another thing that, like, people, like, they see that, like, damn, no one's here, and they're giving their all. Like, there's 10,000 people,
you know,
in here.
Yeah, we just talked about that on here before a little bit. You know,
and like, we make that a point too. Like, even if we're mad about it, like,
straight up,
there's only two people here, man. I'm pissed.
Why y'all?
But you already know, bro. Headbang, lights up, throw some water. The two people in the crowd, like, and we'll get them. And those two people, like, will be, they're buying the merch now. They're hair in my mouth. They're buying the merch now.
I got
now,
you
the
on
tickets.
Plane tickets. Yeah. I work for whoop-de-wop. Yeah, like, or, you never know what.
God forbid, some of them's a promoter. This happened before. One of them's a promoter in the crowd. There's only four people in the crowd. One of them's a promoter. Now we're getting booked for a $2,000 show in a whole different state. Just because we gave it all in front of five people, and he was
one
of those.
It wasn't too ego, because I done seen it with my. Not
this happened
just recently, bro. A nigga got booked, whatever. Didn't even go on stage and perform his shit, and I was just like, "Oh, you're too." And I get it. You reach a certain level,
right?
Well, my bad. You would think you would reach a certain level where there's a good. Oh, this is a good look, or this is a bad look. I understand that. But on the back end, though, I truly believe it's those niggas that can stand 10 toes and go through that human. You know what I'm saying?
They become the Drakes, bro.
Shit, you know, they're gonna have that long.
The longevity.
The longevity.
You gotta humble yourself. People out here, hard head make a soft ass, and like, people don't understand that. I mean, you know, I know you know.
The throwback.
But like, shit, you got to, because it's like, that's what you're saying, essentially, man. People be unhumbly, like, in their glory, bro. And I ain't, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a glorious ass nigga too,
man. That's what I'm saying.
It's like fire behind me, you know?
There's confidence, and then there's arrogance, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Trying to toe that line a little bit, right? You ain't trying to come off arrogant, but you are trying to stand on what you do.
At the same time, you want to be, oh, no, I'm not the best nigga. No, I am the best sitting here, But at the same time, you don't want to, you know what I mean? Like, I'm the best and all of y'all are trash. Like, that's not the energy. It's like, nigga, I'm the best, prove it that I'm wrong at that point.
It's like, once you think you're the best, you plateau and limit, oh, you've maxed out.
And that's the part right there. And that's why we're always,
oh, bro, I can just keep working hard. That's the guy who's got this infinite amount of potential.
Exactly. He's like, oh, just stressing about it every day. I just got to get better.
I watch a lot of anime. Nah,
but it's the truth, though, bro. Like, Dragon Ball Z, bro, I was like, I was going to say, speaking of that, rest in peace to the.
Hey, rest in peace, Akira Toriyama, nigga. Dragon Ball Z, bro.
I gotta put rest in peace, Toriyama. Now I am with the Dragon Balls too.
Love Dragon Ball, goddammit.
Have to.
We were actually we were talking about a topic the other day on our podcast about pain, and I had an example to where I was like, I equated to the hyperbolic time chamber. Whenever you had a threat that you really couldn't beat, or you probably, you know, got beat in a fight, you would go in there and you would turn up the pressure. And you couldn't walk, you couldn't move, but eventually, as you sit in the wait, and the pressure of everything
becomes normalized, and
you become stronger. And then when you leave that,
you operate under intense pressures.
Exactly.
You turn up.
You turn up. You see what I'm saying?
Like you're talking about with Denver. Like,
exactly. So it's like in a way like
perfect analogy.
I love how y'all don't run from the pressure of we only got two
Orlando's
people
a perfect hyper. Metaphorically speaking,
yeah.
Oh, Orlando's a perfect fucking hyperbolic time chamber. Like,
that's, it's bad.
That's one of
the
cities that'll chew your ass up and spit you out
for
it's
sure.
It's like
bro.
A drip or drown.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know. They like Atlanta, LA, New York, but Orlando's one of those hidden gems for real. Like, yeah. Artists
everybody
should be tapping out
Miami
out there.
Instead of like
Orlando.
Yeah.
Miami's cool,
like,
but it's too mainstream.
Cool,
if you want to build a fan base, you want to go to Orlando because that's where people are listening, bro. And like, if they like your music, they're gonna lock in, bro. They're not sugarcoating nothing. Like, there's no.
That's the central point. You can hit Orlando. Now you can branch out to Tampa. You can branch out to Jacksonville.
It's almost one of those, oh, you can make it in Orlando. You can make it anywhere kind of mentalities.
You know, same big O shit. You feel me?
Yeah, like, if you pop in Orlando, then you easy gonna get into my.
Yeah, bro. Especially if you're popping in Orlando and you're stepping out of Orlando now. Yeah, bro. You're inevitably successful.
Best way I can explain is, like, in Colorado, the type of fan, which, mind you, shout out Colorado. That's why we fuck with y'all. It's like you got quality over quantity, right? A quality fan is going to be the one buying the merch, pulling up. When you say put your hands up, they're putting both of them shits up. You feel
opening,
me? That's a quality
up
fan.
The pit.
They're not embarrassed to support you, right? Orlando niggas, it's like, when I say they're more quality, you got to understand why I say it. It's because they're in their fucking ego and, like, won't support you. Like, they could probably fuck with your shit and think that shit was the hardest shit, but it's like, nigga, they're in this public setting and they don't want to look like this lame nigga. Like, they're so it's like, if you can figure out how to make those type niggas want to support you.
Bro, especially when you're up there,
like, you
screaming in the mic and shit.
Yeah.
In their face, bro. in your face, right?
Energy, for sure, bro. But it's crazy because we'll do that in Orlando. Sometimes we'll do a show in Orlando. The crowd kind of won't move. You'll get like a little, not what we're used to, but we'll get off stage and get bombarded by like everybody. Like
on stage, I'm like, oh, fuck y'all niggas, right? Like, y'all aren't fucking with me. I'll get off stage and be like, get bombarded by like, oh, bro, that was the hardest shit I ever seen in my life. I'm like, nigga, I would have not known the way you reacted.
Yeah, like, when you reacted. Maybe they were just like,
nah,
you know,
it's just part of the culture, man.
So when we chalked it up as, all right, they don't know us. They're just listening, analyzing. And that's how we get through it.
But that's why the music's still fire, because, like, you still got to hear it. You know what I'm saying? And, like,
and like you said, we're actually spitting, and, like, people recognize that if you actually a hip-hop head. And, like, that's one thing that people always mention is, like, bro, y'all is rapping, like, the beats and everything is crazy, but I love what y'all are saying. And that's what we get complimented the most, honestly.
Exactly.
The energy and the lyrics.
Stand in your own lane. Continue to do what y'all do.
Yeah, that's our game plan.
Because, like, everybody you see every artist go from the crowds doing exactly what you said to then the crowds going crazy.
Rolling Loud, headlining that, dude.
Exactly.
South by Southwest.
Yeah, headlining it.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
That's
exactly,
the goals,
bro. That's the goals.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what's do y'all have, like, any plans that y'all got coming up, like, outside of South by? Like,
what's on
the docket for y'all?
So then, right after this, we got a show in Boise with DC the Don. He's an up-and-coming artist. The show's almost sold out already.
Yeah.
We've been working the Boise market for some years.
It goes crazy. We ain't even talking about Boise for whatever reason.
We got another festival, too, in San Antonio, actually. On my birthday. Well, the day before my birthday, April 6th.
Month?
Yeah, next month.
I'm an Aries gang.
Yeah, we're actually co-headlining.
We kind of like got to celebrate.
So it's
going to
be crazy.
He's on the 7th,
matter of fact,
I'm
if y'all can pull up, I can get y'all in for free.
Man, hey, I'm pulling up.
Yeah, that's one of those ones I want y'all at because we co-headlining and it's almost sold out already. So I need y'all at that one. You know what I'm saying?
Be pulling up.
That was going to go crazy, I promise you.
We're going to film the whole thing, too.
Yeah, that shit going to go nuts.
Yeah, bro, if you can, that shit be crazy. Do a little interview in the backstage or something. Like, yo, backstage San Antonio, you already know the vibes. Yeah, that'll be lit. We can make it happen for sure. The promoter, he loves me. So
we've just been focusing on the festival, and we got these passports, and we're about to run this shit up out of it.
Oh, yeah, I was going to tell you. I was going to tell you, we did do an overseas. I touched on it for a second. We did an overseas run. We did London, Paris, and Amsterdam.
About
that. He's talking about spiritual journey at South by Southwest. That was my spiritual journey for sure.
Wait, Paris or London?
The whole run was spiritual. The whole run was like,
oh my soul.
I felt like I found myself. came back home and just went crazy.
Man, you mentioned that like it was just a little like tiny, like, you know, like out, you know, out the garage or something. But nah, you was really out there, London, out there, Amsterdam, where
it happened? Paris. It happened crazy too. Like we was on Instagram. Shout out my homie LaPrince, and he's a reggaetronics artist. So it's like EDM but reggae. It's so fire when y'all hear it. Oh my god, it's so fire. Shout out LaPrince. But he found me on Instagram, sent me a song that was just crazy. It was like a, he had like a Danish dude like rapping in like that language. I'm not sure what it is. He had he's from the Netherlands, so he had like a couple bars in like that and like English back and forth. Yeah. And then I had like a couple bars in Spanish and English. So the track is like super international as hell right now. So we did that song. He invited me out to do the show in Amsterdam. So like, you know how we take advantage, we were saying earlier, we take advantage of everything. We started emailing.
That's how you do it.
We started emailing venues. We started looking at the closest routes in Europe. And started emailing venues and promoters to promote at other do shows at other venues.
Same shit.
And told them we have a show in Amsterdam with LaPrince. And like we started, that's how we got London, Paris.
The rest of our tour around this scenario.
So we used that opportunity to do the one song with LaPrince on stage in Amsterdam and ended up booking a show in Paris that we're headlining. A show in London that we were headlining.
You feel me? I ended up plugging in with the studio in Paris, so I got some music.
Yeah, we recorded a whole. We recorded mad music in Paris. So it was crazy. Went to the Eiffel Tower and like.
Oh yeah, as a bro trip though, I ain't gonna lie. Like we was already locked in, but like shit, we passport bros too, nigga. What you mean?
And it was crazy because none of us had our passports when we got booked for that Amsterdam show.
At all.
So he was like, and we told him, none of us had a passport, and we was like, we're going to be there. Yeah, and we made it happen. Oh, yeah, I think everybody got their passport. His passport came in like 3 days before we left.
God.
And mind you, he bought the tickets, like everything, like if he already had the passport.
And I got my, I did it right too.
Sweating, bro, and that shit came like... Like 3-4 days before we left, yo, and everything just worked so smoothly when we went out.
You
know, there's just been so many times in our career moment where it was like, it's like the universe will test your conviction. So, like, leading up to the inevitable, whatever the gratification is, whether it be you meet the celebrity or you get the photo or you get the fan or whatever it is, leading up to it, the universe will test your nuts, nigga. So there's just been so many moments where it's like, but the thing about the spinning it back into the international trip, it was slightly opposite. Everything was going good. Oh, this is going too good.
Yeah, too good, too good.
Too good. You worry about it almost. Boom. Yeah, no, everything's going good. I'm running this up, doing this, this, and that, right? Amsterdam, good as fuck. Run it up, successful trip shrooms. I don't know what I could talk about on this podcast. Who's out there doing Amsterdam business? Boom, hit Paris. You feel me? I'm in Paris, running it up, man. Them fucking homeless in Paris is a whole separate story, y'all. But being in the fashion district and just running it up in Paris, me personally, I fell. Y'all know what happened in Paris. I fell in love twice in Paris. And shout out my Paris boos. I'm gonna see y'all when I see y'all. You know what I'm saying? And then we went to London, right? So London, boom. This is, mind you, we went out here, bruh. Nigga, the world motherfucking, what's the biggest, the World Cup with soccer? Soccer shit, like every 4 years, what is it? World Cup. Nigga, that shit was going on. Everybody's turned the fuck up. As an American, I did not realize, nigga, we're sleeping.
Oh, no, they were going crazy. Like,
especially, that's like Super Bowl times 100 out there, yo. It's crazy.
The streets of London is like streets.
No, and people out there are really willing to die about that.
Standing on straight business.
No, for real. Business. Like, it's like a gang or something, bro. It's like they're willing to die behind their team.
Oh, yeah? Just met y'all. We finna go fight.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, bro. We're from America.
So, boom. We go out there. Everything's cool, right? Whoop-de-wop. We go to Camden. This is in London, if y'all know.
Yeah, Camden Town.
We hit up Camden. We go do our show. We tap in with the people. Boom. We see the snow is like one of those like, oh, this, it's finally snowed on Christmas. It's a white Christmas type moment. Mind you, this is happening during the holiday season, right?
Hold on. First red flag. First red flag. I'll let you continue. First red flag. Oh, it hasn't snowed out here in like 20 years.
No.
First red flag.
First of all, Swizzy, we didn't understand this red flag. In our mind, we're like, oh, we're in London. Slightly
cold. It's snowing everywhere, right? We thought this is normal.
Oh, this is just like a beautiful moment we're having. Like a special, the snow was hitting so nostalgically. Oh, my God. Boom.
My most popping videos I shot right there because it starts snowing. We just all hit the content off
it
top.
It went viral. It went like a million views.
Yeah, got the viral off that shit because it never snowed, bro. Like, what?
My shit got like my most viral video on Instagram right now is me on the London Bridge during this snow, right? So we're all thinking like this is just normal, right? Nigga, turns to find out, bro, it hasn't snowed in fucking London in
decades.
So this is a red flag that we're not understanding, bro. This is like a whoa.
We're having fun in here, like, yay.
So boom, all right, cool. We gotta fuck around and leave now. Now we gotta leave, okay? So boom, all three of us got our shit to where Amsterdam's our connecting flight, and we're about to head back to U.S. So we gotta make it. It's like road back to Amsterdam. Okay, so boom. So out in Europe now, mind you, us Americans, we're so motherfucking spoiled. Nigga, there ain't no, we're sitting here banging the Ubers, boom, boom, or Uber, just gotta be a taxi. Nigga, everyone kept denying our shit. The ticket was like 60, 70 bucks, I was like, that seems excessive. Yeah. Niggas still weren't trying to fucking accept our shit. We're not understanding this shit, so we're like, oh, nigga, everyone's taking the fucking, they do trains and shit, they do like buses and shit. That's actually like the norm, and us Americans think cars is the norm, it's actually very sorry, nigga. But anyways, boom, that's a whole separate comment. We hop on the train, and now the story starts. So we're all like trying to get, so the main goal here is, okay, guys, this is all fun and games, let's get to the airport before our flight and handle our business. It's our first time in the international system. We don't know no better. We're just trying to get over there. Like America.
Like Russian, too.
We get on the fucking train, bruh. How did this shit turn into Resident Evil 5, nigga?
No, Resident Evil.
Yeah, bro, Resident Evil zombie apocalypse.
Flicker, flicker. The lights shut off. The train stops in the middle of nowhere.
No, no, no. Explain the follow-up, because it was fucked. The guy was like, we think we're going to have to turn around. Like, saying real, like, scary shit.
The tracks. That's what he said, nigga.
We're trapped.
I'm like, oh, we're finna, yes, the conductor.
Dude driving a train? Talking about what?
So we got to turn it back around. We can't move forward. It's dangerous. That's
no,
what
no,
he
no.
Saying.
He's like, this is life of life threatening.
Life threatening, bro. That's we were key words. We were starting panicking.
We're sitting nigga, with we're the stewardesses, the, and the stewardesses are panicking right next to us. Yeah.
Like, nigga. Plain flight attendant. My shout out, homegirl. What's her name, bro? She saved Noopy, bitch ass nigga. Noopy got saved. Me and this nigga got y'all. We'll talk about it. We'll lead up to it. So, anyways, we're sitting next to the flight attendants. They're looking at us like, whoa, whoopty wop, whoopty wop. Nigga, the lights on the train started like flickering, like.
Then you heard the brakes before you felt them.
And so they called it. So in Colorado, right? It's a snow day, average snow. I'm from Colorado, for real, nigga.
Oh, blizzard.
Oh, just a normal day in Colorado. Mm-hmm. Out there, they're calling this shit an Arctic blast, a historical Arctic blast.
Arctic blast is historical. It's freezing the engines of the airplanes. No planes in all of Europe are leaving, bro. Airport. We have to catch our flight to come back to America.
Really did do that, though. It really did just freeze real quick.
Oh, and mind you, and one thing I hated about it, when I was out there, the shit that started bothering me.
Which was?
Us Americans, we're so used to working and having to get shit done. We have this sense of urgency, nigga.
There was no sense of urgency. Oh, there was to make it worse, Amsterdam airport was on strike.
Oh, yeah.
All the employees had picket fences on, we're not working, we want
to
raise.
Damn, though, before we even got to Amsterdam, nigga, so the flight attendant homegirl seen us, obviously we're on our rapper shit, she seen the fear and panic in our eyes on some, like, nigga, what the fuck is about to happen? She held us down and made sure me and Swizzy got compensated on our shit, and Noopy's flight, I don't know how his flight was set up, but this nigga's shit was
he escaped,
was like,
bro. He escaped.
Mind you, you know what I'm saying? I was waiting on my passport, so, like, I was trying to hold out. I was, like, holding out on my shit. Grabbed a whole different flight, bro, you know what I'm saying? But, like, everything was supposed to be, like, there. We supposed to then diverge.
Right. Amsterdam, and then we go
out. You know, in the movies where the nigga's like, I'm not trying to leave you behind. I'm coming back.
Go without me.
Go without me. You know what I'm
saying? Bro, that's what it felt like. You know, he got on a plane. He escaped the Arctic.
I did. I was at home looking at these niggas. So these are my brothers.
Bro, we were out there for an extra 3-4 days, bro.
Amsterdam, I forgot where they ended up putting.
Wait, bro. We were walking around the airport. That shit looked like Resident Evil refugee camp, bro. I'm talking about niggas was laying across like this on the airport floor, bro. And we're walking American as fuck over niggas, bro. And niggas.
The airport looked like a homeless shelter. That shit was crazy. I'm talking about everyone sleeping on the floor, kids, adults.
Amsterdam?
Bro, no, that was
no London. No,
was it London? London. It was London airport.
Oh, you're not talking about the homeless shelter.
Yes, bro.
Dude, that shit was.
The world is fucked. So we just trying to rage. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Instead of killing people, let it out in the mosh pit. You know what I'm saying? Let it out in the mosh pit, bro. Go home happy.
And, try not to go there on public because you feel me. You feel me. But as far as us though. We support LGBTQ. We don't give a fuck where you from. It's about where you're going. If you're a supporter of us, you're we respect that, and that's enough for us to want to stay connected with you. You know what I'm saying? It's just for us, it'd be about like morals and vows. It'd be like certain lines where it's like,
you're talking about scumbags and non-scumbags.
There's got to be like, okay, I can respect
you. Yeah, bro, good people and evil people, bro.
Can't just respect the nigga, you know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you support me, Hitler?
Yeah, dude, you're evil.
Yeah, nigga, no, nigga, you can't be my fan, nigga. Yeah. You feel me? I'm sorry, bro. You feel me? Yeah, if we want to go there, but anyway.
Nah, 100%, man. I think, not
to alienate our fans.
I think y'all dropped some gems, too, man. If you're an artist, an upcoming artist, too, man, you're going to hear a lot of gems in this podcast because, like you said, man, like, y'all are on the hashtags. You know what I'm saying? You were hustling. It's not like you had a show and you just went to just do the show. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's so many pivots that y'all made and adjustments that y'all made to try to become successful, and y'all still doing that. And that's why I applaud y'all, man.
Because we appreciate that. Because that's hard work. Some of that, you know, goes unnoticed. A lot of people don't even pay mind unless it's, oh, y'all are in front of 4,000 people. Now we're going to show love. Oh, like, yeah. People don't see this right here, the work ethic that goes behind staying up all night, hitting 100 podcasts. We're not going to sleep unless we have 50 podcasts each DM. You know what I'm saying? Like, they don't see that at all. Like, we don't document that. We probably should, low-key. But, that's, like,
so behind the scenes. So any type of recognition, you know what I'm saying, we humbly accept and appreciate because we work so much. Motherfucking hard for it, nigga. So we appreciate that. Like, as Loud Life, the entity. Yeah.
You can tell the people who work for it and the people who don't, because the people who work for it are almost always grateful, appreciative, and understand, you know, what each thing is. Like,
we understand the value of it.
Exactly. Each engagement, just each person. Like, you understand what one fan can do
exactly,
for you.
Exactly, so bro. It like, can change your life.
Straight up, bro.
And a lot of artists don't realize that. If you are listening, you're an artist, bro, one person can change your life, bro, overnight. It's happened to us a couple times, bro. We used to perform in freaking... what was it, the Royal Castle? The capacity was like 50 people, and like there was only 5 people there. We used to do that like every day. Just, I mean, that's how we got good at performing, though.
Yeah,
but
bro. You know, low key, you got to look as an independent artist. One little piece the of grind. Advice I would give y'all is
the grind.
You got to look at those fucked up situations as rehearsal, nigga.
Uh-huh. Rehearsal
practice
and
rehearsal. That's like a better way to
take
go
a
about
step
it.
Back. Look at what you can take advantage of. Like, all right, there's only 5 people here. Let me at least get these 5 people to follow me.
And lock in with your fucking fans, yeah. Man. Like, that's yeah, lock really, in. Really
important.
Good. As an independent artist, like, you have to show we locked them. In with our fans. And, like, mm-hmm. The fans will open up the city for you. Mm-hmm. Like, the whole city. Like, mm-hmm. Niggas playing on, like, perfect God mode or some shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, literally, the city will open if you lock in with your peoples. And, like, you'll find them. Yeah, like, bro. we done met some scumbags, but we done met, you know what I'm saying, the realest motherfuckers on this journey, mm-hmm. Man. And like we still locked in with them now when we go to the city, and like now we popping in their city, they the ones, and it's like that's rightfully so, you know.
That's how we're able to do like our tours now, is like we was just opening up for people all over the country, and now like those same promoters then seen us so many times, sell tickets, whatever the case may be, promote, perform really well, and now they're booking us for headlining. Every time we're like, oh, we're doing a tour, we don't get no hesitation for those cities. They're what date, what venue? Those are the questions we get.
Yeah, this was the respect, you know what I'm saying? Literally. It's like, all you, as a man, all you got is your balls and your word. And so as an artist, when we're pulling up and we're meeting you, whether the business is financial or if it's a ticket, you know what I'm saying?
A crowd draw.
However, yeah. We got to get that promotional thing, you know what I'm saying? We're standing on business over
yeah,
here.
Yeah, yeah. That's one thing we're going to always do is make sure contractually everything's checked off on our end. Yeah.
And then one other thing, you know what I'm saying? Forever Louds, if we're looking for artists. I know I am, personally.
I did want to tap in on that, actually. So just a couple, in January, we just started a record label called Forever Loud Records. Now, with that record label, we just signed a distribution deal with that record label with Empire Distribution. So what we're trying to do is find artists that are independent, obviously, that work with, like, TuneCore or DistroKid that want their music distributed through an actual major record label without having the, oh, I'm signed and can't drop music, the freedom of still being independent, pretty much. Yeah. So the distribution has, like, over 2,000 stores. There's no do-it-yourself distribution company that's putting your music out like that. You're only getting that many stores and that much reach with an actual major label. And where we're blessing people at is, like, we're putting out their music
without, and they're 100% independent. They can go sign a record deal with Atlantic Records. Like, we don't have any ties with any of that. We're literally on some distribution, artist development kind of thing.
I'm right looking now for that hunger, and I'm looking for people to come with it, though. You know, I'm not
yeah,
just,
like, you gotta oh, really be outside.
I'm Joe Schmo, whoop-de-wop, sorry,
yeah,
bro.
That part, yeah. Like, I mean, we know, but as y'all can see, like, we know what we're looking for.
But with that being said, that is the idea, though. Come tap in with the team. Forever Loud.
Forever Loud.
Yeah, that's something Life that we just started. It's going to be very big by the end of the year, for sure. We're about to invest a lot into it. Yeah.
Congratulations. Yeah, y'all going to see a lot more of them, man. So tap in. Y'all pay attention. You're going to see them here in Austin again and again and again. So get used to it, man.
Yes, sir. Shit.
Hey, y'all know what it is. Shout out Halftime Company for having us. You know what I'm
saying?
Big
shout out to Halftime Company.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, it wouldn't be possible if they didn't allow us to pull up on them. So it's mad blessings. I appreciate it, for real, for real.
So, man.
Real talk. Y'all came with the shit. Y'all on that shit. Y'all can find us at loudlifecrew.com. Look it up on Google, wherever you want.
It'll be up forever.
Me personally, nigga, Marvelous. I got marvelous.s, marvelus. Come fuck with me. Come tap in with me. I appreciate everybody in Austin that's been fucking with me. It's such a vibe out here. Let's run it up.
Yes, sir. And I'm Swizzy B. You can catch me at The Real Swizzy B. That's on all social medias. LoudLifeCrew.com is the hub, so you already know.
And I'm Noopy Neyman, The Real Noopy. That's N-O-O-P-E-Y. No, I got to spell that shit. LoudLifeCrew.com, though. Obviously, we pushing that. Make sure you
that's
go
the
there.
That's the hub.
Sign up to the Life of Legion.
Yeah, the mailing list. Yeah.
See y'all tap in. See y'all tap in, family. We appreciate y'all.
Appreciate you, man. Yes, sir.